Okay, hello and welcome everyone. I'm glad you all could join us when it's Friday night. We do have Spanish interpretation available, so please click on the globe icon at the bottom of your screen and please click on your appropriate listening language. Tonight's webinar will focus on understanding what a holdover and non-payment case is and the process of this legal proceeding. You know, Palante gets calls from many clients who are in housing court or have been served with these types of cases. And this webinar is truly to educate, you know, everyone on this webinar on what to do and how to respond. So tonight we have our very own attorney, Jeremiah Schlodman, who is Palante's legal director. Jeremiah understands the process very well, and he will be presenting and answering all the questions that everyone has tonight. We have a Q&A box, and that's how we will be answering the questions. So I do ask that everyone place their questions there. So I will have Jeremiah start. Mm-hmm. Introduce himself.
Hello. So, hello. Once again, I'm Jeremiah Schlotman. So, Jakari introduced me. I lead the legal department of Palante Harlem, which is a really wonderful position for those of you who haven't heard this from me already, because many of you may know that Palante has been doing really great work in this field in tenants' rights, particularly uptown Manhattan and the Bronx, since 2009. But our legal department's fairly new, just the last couple of years. We've been in business, but you know, we're growing, and it's really exciting because we can chart a different way of doing legal representation for tenants in the nonprofit sector. So basically our legal department complements what Palante's already been doing for many years. So, you know, the activism and the effectiveness that they've had. So it's an honor to be here. This is one component of many things that Palante loves to do so that we can disseminate information as much as possible, stay connected to the community, empower folks, just be there fighting alongside you all. So I'll quickly just, my goal tonight, you all have seen the title of the webinar. My goal is to paint a very general picture of the housing court process. You know, some of you here tonight may have already gone through the housing court process and, to some degree, right? So you may be already somewhat familiar with some of the things I'm going to be saying. But I did want to just keep it sort of as fundamental and basic as I could because, first off, I don't know if all of you have been through the process. So, it's good to start at the base. But also importantly is because New York City housing law is a very complicated mess. It's a very tangled web of a lot of laws, regulations, and directives. And we're talking federal, state, and local. So, you know, there's different types of Section 8, there's public housing, there are special tax abatements that the state gives folks, there's rent-regulated housing, free market housing, market housing, mixed income. I mean, I can go on and on, supportive housing, three-quarters housing, right? So you get the point. So that's why I want to break it down to the most fundamental, because even if you have some exposure to to the housing court process, because of how complicated it is, or, you know, folks, it may be hard to wrap your mind around a lot of it, or you may just be sort of in your mindset if you are, you know, a certain type of tenant and you've only been through a certain type of case. Okay. So, with that, let's get into the substance. So there are very broadly two types of eviction cases in New York City housing court. That's it, okay? For all the stuff and tangled weave I just talked about, there are two basic types. Those are non-payment cases and holdover cases, right? Non-payment case is pretty self-explanatory. That's a case that a landlord starts in housing court against a tenant because the landlord is alleging that the tenant has failed to pay rent, right? that is a non-payment. That's what it's all about. That's what it comes down to. The other type of case is holdover. And holdover case simply means any other type of eviction case that does not have to do with the tenant's failure to pay, the alleged failure to pay. Okay, so that's it, really. It's that simple at the end of the day, non-payment versus holdover. But with that being said, I will get into a little more detail on holdovers because non-payments are non-payments, right? That's what it's all about. Holdovers, there are some subcategories, as you might be able to imagine, because there are a lot of reasons why a landlord might try to evict a tenant. And so the way I'm going to map it out is just to quickly go over the process, the legal procedure in New York City Housing Court for these cases. So that, and along the way, we'll see if we can delve a little bit more in detail. So the process is, before even suing a tenant in housing court, the landlord has to give a notice, an official notice to the tenant that says, you have to do something or else I will sue you for eviction, okay? This notice is called the predicate notice, all right? So that is, predicate just means before, right? So before, it's the notice before the housing court case, right? In a non-payment case, the predicate notice will be a 14-day rent demand, right? So for some of you who were in housing court maybe many years ago, it used to be, you know, much shorter. You would get, people would see like 5-day rent demands. But ever since the law changed in June 2019 with stronger protections, now tenants are entitled to a 14-day rent demand before a landlord can sue you for non-payment, all right? In a holdover, their predicate notices are different. There are generally three types of predicate notices, right? Depending on the type of holdover, right? They are called notice to quit, a notice to cure, or a notice of termination. So remember, what are reasons, you know, you could get evicted besides non-payment? Well, someone might have a dog that they're not supposed to have because it's prohibited by the lease. Or the landlord might allege you don't actually live there, right? You're not the tenant. Or they might allege you are subleasing it, you know, renting it out to someone else without the permission of the landlord. You know, or they could say you're a nuisance, which means you're causing problems in the building, right? Maybe you're blasting your music in the middle of the night and bothering tenants, right? I could go on and on, but those are just a few examples of types of holdovers, okay? Depending on the type of holdover, that will determine what the name of your predicate notice is, okay? Now, I'm not gonna get, like I said, too much into the technical specifications, but I did wanna give you the names so you've heard them before. And just know that depending on the type of case, that will determine whether you get a notice to quit, notice to cure, or a notice of termination, all right? Now, the predicate notice under the law, the reason why they have to give this to you before they can sue you is because the law is trying to protect the tenant a little. They are trying to give the tenant the chance to avoid an eviction case before it even happens. Okay, that's the point of the predicate notice, to give you notice. Landlord says to the tenant, I have a problem with you, or you haven't paid me, or some other reason. And they say, fix this problem by such and such date, or else I will sue you. Okay, so wrapping it back together, that's what the predicate notice, why it exists, and that's, you know, what it's meant to do. I wanted to make a quick note here, actually, for those of you that are rent regulated tenants, which means rent controlled or rent stabilized, all right? So many of you probably are, by the way, if you didn't already know, you have a lot more protections than what are called market tenants, all right? So, you know, if you are rent controlled or rent stabilized, you can only be evicted for certain reasons under the law, Okay. So you have additional protections. Just know that. All right. And the predicate notice has to list the specific reason why they're evicting you, and it has to be one of the reasons that the law allows. Just want to make that quick note for you all. That's important to point out. All right. So let's move forward in the legal procedure. All right. So we just talked about the predicate notice. That's the notice that you get. The landlord is warning you, I'm going to sue you if we don't fix the problem in this notice before the date on the notice, right? The deadline on the notice. What would be the next step? The next thing that the tenant would get if you are unable to resolve the issue, it are two documents. These are called the petition and the notice of petition, right? When you get these documents, you have been sued in housing court, right? Now there is a case 100% against you in housing court, right? The way that people get these notices or court papers, which is a lawsuit, really, that's how you can think of it. It's a lawsuit in housing court. The way people get these court papers or this lawsuit is there are various ways. There's a procedure under the law for how you should get it, all right? The law prefers that people get personal service. This is the famous service that people may have seen, you know, on television, or you just know about it when people like knock on the door, show up wherever the person is who's getting sued, and they say, hey, are you so-and-so? If the person says yes, they say, here you are, you've been served, right? That's what the law prefers. But if the landlord cannot do that type of service, under the law, they have to make two attempts, one basically during business hours and one after, so kind of like a day and night thing. Then they have alternatives. So many of you probably got, if you've been sued, you most likely got these papers, if not by personal, then you probably got it in the mail, along with something slipped under your door or taped on your door. Okay. All right. So a lawsuit has started. The next step in the court process is that the tenant is supposed to file their answer to the petition. All right. So again, remember, the petition is the housing court lawsuit by the landlord against the tenant. So then what the tenant has to do is file what's called the answer to the petition. And the answer contains the tenant's defenses. And if they have counterclaims, then they can put counterclaims. All right. So for example, if it's a non-payment petition, the tenant might file an answer saying, that's not true. I don't owe them money. I paid that money and the landlord is the one who messed up in crediting me, right? That's the defense. I actually paid it, right? So that's what's the next step. Tenant files an answer. Here, I want to note something important again, and this is very important. For holdover cases, the tenant will get the court papers, the petition and the notice of petition, with a court date already assigned, all right? So I'm going to repeat it. The landlord's lawsuit, called the petition and notice of petition, when that is given to the tenant will get those papers and there will already be a court appearance date on the papers, all right? So the tenant will have to show up if you don't want to lose your case by failing to appear, right? So that's very important to know. Because it is different from the non-payment, right? In a non-payment case, the court papers will not have a court date on it, right? So one will not be automatically assigned. There still is a lawsuit against you. It is an active lawsuit, but there's no court date yet, right? No appearance in court. The petition will tell you, then, and notice of petition will tell you that the tenant needs to file the answer, right? And remember what the answer is. It has the tenant's defenses and their counterclaims. In a non-payment petition, it will say, the tenant, you must file your answer within 10 days, all right, of service of these papers on you. That's the difference. So remember, holdover petition already comes with a court date that you have to go to. All right. You didn't, that's that. Non-payment will say, will not give you a court date. And they'll say, go down to the clerk, file your answer within 10 days. Okay. Once the tenant files their answer to the non-payment petition, then the court will assign you a court date. All right. So that's what triggers that. Now, so you may ask yourself too, when do I file the answer in a holdover? If I, you know, if I already had a court date and I didn't get a chance to file it. Well, don't worry about that, especially if you're unrepresented, because you'd be able to file your answer before the court date, or you could even do it on the court date or after the court date, or you could talk to the judge about it to get more time to file it. You, in my experience, I can tell you, you will be given time to file that answer. All right. If you need to. So here's a little practical real life application of what I just told you about the non-payment petition, the answer. So a lot of people will, you know, get nervous and they say, oh, wow, I have to file an answer within 10 days. So if day 8 and 9 rolls around, they'll get very worried, you know, that they could lose just because they didn't file the answer, you know, or sometimes people get court papers, right? And they'll say, the date says, you know, March 1st, but I just got it and it's March 20th. And it says file within 10 days. What, am I late? You know, these are typical questions and understandably so. Okay. So let me tell you a little something here. The technical, legal, and the best advice, by the way, this is the best advice. You should file your answer within 10 days. However, sometimes for strategic reasons or practical reasons, people cannot or do not want to file the answer, right? And remember what I told you, well, you don't get a court date until you file an answer. Right? So here's a practical side. On the 11th day, the court isn't going to automatically default you. All right. The burden is on the landlord after the time to answer expires to go to court and file more papers asking for the tenant to lose because they never came to court to answer. All right. So there's these practical protections that you have because, you know, that's money, that's time, you know, more effort that the landlord has to expend to get a judgment against you. So as a practical matter, a lot of times it's very common to see that tenants will not be defaulted, right? Which means they lose automatically for failing to come to court. You will not see a tenant defaulted on the 11th day. Very common that it will take time after that. And I can tell you right now, don't ask me how much time because there is no exact clock. It depends on the landlord, how active they are in going back to court to say, hey, the tenant never showed up, give me a judgment. You know, it could be on the 14th day, it could be 2 months later, it could be 4 months later, it could be never, all right? Just so you know. Right, so that's a little practical tidbit. Moving on. So after the tenant files their answer, right? So there are, there's a process that happens here. So it is very common on the very first court date for the case, if it doesn't settle, then for it to be adjourned, right? Which means the case will be postponed to another date. There will be another appearance. Another practical tidbit here for folks. If you are unrepresented on the first court date, you will almost 100% of the time get an adjournment from the judge automatically, no questions asked, okay? If you say, I want to have time to try to get an attorney, right? Sometimes you'll hear the judge say, you know, time to seek counsel, you know, or time to retain counsel. Sometimes they say stuff like that, but that means time to look for an attorney who will represent you, all right? Even the most landlord-friendly judge is going to know if it's the first court date and you're unrepresented, that they should grant that request, okay? So very important too. I know court can be a lot of pressure for people. Sometimes it's the most stressful thing that anyone's ever experienced, you know, and understandably so. This is the roof over your head. So I want people to know that. These are very important practical tips that, you know, it's not going to just solve your housing court case, but it could give you time. It can help you strategize. You know, I want people to know different, you know, these things so that you can rest a little bit easier. All right. On the first court date, you can get that adjournment. Tell them you want to seek an attorney. All right. Now, as far as, you know, the title says navigating the non-payment and holdover cases. So, you know, it's important for me to tell you the legal process and the procedure, but it's not just an informational here about here's technically what happens, right? I want to throw in the practical stuff to help you represent yourself if you can't find an attorney, or, you know, even if you have an attorney, you know, you're entitled to a, you know, good representation, and you're entitled to know what's going on in your case. It's your life, right? It's the roof over your head. So I want people to know these things too, so that they can protect themselves or they understand what their attorneys may be looking for or talking about, right? So one thing that people should know is, you know, before you file the answer, preferably, but even if you already filed the answer, you can ask the judge to, you know, update your answer, right? Which means amend your answer is what they'll say in court within a certain amount of time. What you should include in the answer is you should make sure, see if there's technical issues. You might have technical legal defenses that could help you get the case dismissed. So people should be looking for technical issues. Now, of course, if you don't have an attorney already, I get it. You're like, what are the technical issues? And that can get very complex. But if you at least are kind of know this, like, you know, I'm going to give you some general little things here and hints. You know, sometimes people can't get an attorney, but they can talk to someone knowledgeable, or they at least get to have a consultation with an attorney, right? So even if they don't take your case, they may have a consultation. So if you already are thinking about like, hey, are there technical issues? You can talk about that with a lawyer, right? So what are technical issues? Well, these are things that are not about the what the case is about, right? The core of the case, right? So a non-payment case, it's about tenant never paid the rent, or at least they say so, right? Holdover case, it's about whatever else the landlord claims is happening, you know, or the tenant is doing, right? So a technical defense has nothing to do with like, oh, I actually paid the rent, or no, I'm not a nuisance, I don't blast my music, right? No, I don't do drugs in the apartment, right? Technical issues are about, hey, they didn't serve me right. They didn't serve me correctly by law, right? That's a technical issue. So technical issues, they don't win you the case permanently. The landlord can refile the case, all right? That's important to know. However, technical issues sometimes can be very important to people for strategic reasons, or sometimes people have cases that are pretty simple, like a non-payment, and the tenant says, you're right, I didn't pay the rent. I don't have real defenses here, right? A technical issue might help get the case dismissed to buy you time, because you know that job starting in 2 weeks, right? Because by then, when the landlord starts the case over, you know, maybe you'll be able to come to a settlement agreement because you know you can pay, right? So technical issues mostly have to do with things like that. Like, what's the service, right? Did they serve you like they were supposed to? Did they make two attempts to give you the lawsuit, right? And remember, a lawsuit in housing court is a petition and notice of petition. Other types of technical defenses are the predicate notice was defective. All right. That's another like technical thing, because remember, we're looping back around to where we started. What is a predicate notice? It's the notice before the lawsuit is filed, and it has to contain the details of what the landlord has issue with you, right? Or an issue with, right? So the law has a lot of technical specifications about what those notices are supposed to say. So if your notice doesn't give you enough details or enough information to avoid the lawsuit, right? Because that's the point. Point is to be able, the law says, oh, the tenant should have a opportunity to resolve the issue. So give them the predicate notice before suing them. Well, what if the predicate notice is super vague? What if it just says, you've been blasting the music out of your apartment, so I'm going to, so stop it in 10 days or else I'm going to sue you, right? You might be like, what? When? What was it? Was it that one random workout where I was like jamming out at from 3 to 5 on a Saturday, right? Or are they trying to say you're doing it in the middle of the night in the work week, right? You don't know. I mean, or you might know, but the notice doesn't tell you the details of what they're specifically saying, right? So you may be able to get the case dismissed, but remember, those are technical. They could resue you, but just doing it properly. All right. So look for technical issues. The next part are what are called substantive issues, right? So these are the issues of substance. These are the issues that is the whole reason for the lawsuit, the eviction lawsuit, right? So those are, we'll give you all sorts of defenses. Again, I don't want to go down a rabbit hole here. So I could give a whole nother Zoom on certain technical defenses and counterclaims that people should be looking out for. But this is where I'm going to drop my little practical nugget, again here. If you get a non-payment case and you are a rent regulated tenant, which it means rent controlled or rent stabilized, always order your what is called rent history from the New York State Division of Housing and Community Renewal. So what you'll hear Palante say, and a lot of people, it's by its initials. They'll say DHCR. They'll say, get your DHCR rent history. And I'm telling you, get that rent history. That's what it's called. And what the rent history shows you, it shows you, all of the amounts that were charged or that the landlord registered with the state every year for your apartment. Because remember, you have more protections when you're a rent regulated tenant. And one of those protections is they can't just jump the rent up by any amount they want. It's only for certain reasons. So that's a little practical nugget there. Get the DHCR rent history if you have a non-payment and you're a rent regulated tenant, okay? Reading it is a whole nother issue, but you'll be able to find someone who can read it or help you read it, but you just need that. And, you come to Palante with various issues, a lot of times we're going to tell you to get that rent history, right? And come back to us when you get it, all right? So that's the practical bit there. All right, I want to leave some time for questions. So I'm going to wrap up here soon with the presentation, but then I want to just show you some visuals before we go to Q&A, all right? So really quickly too, generally in the court process, there are two types of, they call them parts, all right? Parts, housing parts. That means the courtrooms, right? In housing court. They have what is called the resolution part, and then there's the trial part. The resolution part is where all cases start, right? That's the judge that has to try to resolve the case before trial. That can involve anything. If the case, they can try to help the case settle, or they can hear a motion to dismiss because of a technical issue, or a motion on a substantive issue, right? There's different things that they can try to do or try to get different things they can see if they can get the case resolved, right, in the resolution part. But if the case does not get resolved or settled in the resolution part, then you will go to the trial part. The case will be transferred to a different judge. And the point of that judge is to have the trial. That's everything. That's the testimony, evidence, all of that. And yes, you can do a trial unrepresented. It happens a lot more than it should be happening, but it does. So just know that. Here is the practical good news though, all right? Not that you're gonna be, it's not that it's gonna make you like a lot more calmer, right? If you have to represent yourself in a trial, but it should help a little bit, I would hope. One thing I want you to remember, if you get to that unfortunate reality where you're in a trial for your eviction case and you don't have an attorney, the rules, the technical rules of trials are very relaxed for tenants who are not attorneys, okay? So the judge is going to give you a lot of leeway, okay? A lot of opportunity to, and they're gonna ask you questions to try to help you get the evidence submitted properly. Okay, so just know that it at least is relaxed. So you don't have to be all technical. You don't have to cram 3 years of law school and a bar exam in your head in 1 month before you go represent yourself. Not at all. right? And last thing I wanted to point out, another thing that I like to emphasize very much as a practical piece here. Please be aware that if you are unrepresented, a settlement agreement, well, even if you are represented, you know, it depends how good your attorney is and if they're listening to you and get in resolving things properly. But particularly if you are unrepresented, please be aware that even settlement agreements can have traps, all right, for the tenant. So there's different things. For example, if it's a non-payment agreement, if they have, if you don't pay all the rent by a certain date, let's say you agree to pay $10,000 in 1 month, right? Yes, that's your settlement agreement. If you paid them $9,900 at the end of that month and you didn't do that last one, the agreement might allow them to evict you or to serve you a marshal's notice to evict you for that $100 that's lacking, okay? There's other types of agreements and holdovers that says, okay, we're not going to go to trial. We'll let you stay here, but they're going to give you probation. And it might be for a long time. And they'll say, if you do this or that within 2 years, then we are entitled to evict you. So please be aware that settlements might help you breathe easy at the moment, but make sure if you don't have an attorney, you ask the court, the people who work for the court, that's the court attorney and the judge, please ask them questions about the settlement. If you don't understand, it's so important that you understand the agreement and the consequences of different things, okay? All right, that's the overview. Really quickly, Jakari, if you could please put up on the screen. I just have a few documents to show people to give you visuals to reconnect what we just talked about. All right, so look, remember I told you there's non-payment holdover. Here's one type of holdover. It's based on the violations. All right, so here. Remember one of them I told you about? Notice to cure. That generally will give you 10 days. And what this means is you are doing something against the lease. And if you don't stop doing it within 10 days, then we're going to sue you, right? And they call it notice to cure because it's a condition that you're not supposed to be, it's something you're not supposed to be doing, but you can cure it, you know, in quotation marks, meaning you can fix it within 10 days. So for example, if your lease prohibits washing machines in the apartment, but you have one and the landlord finds out, they would probably give you this notice, a 10-day notice to cure, which will say, basically in really legal terms, it will say, get that washing machine out of there within 10 days or we're suing you for eviction, all right? But I just wanted you to see, connect these dots. See that title there that says 10-day notice to cure. And just so you can see, it says, please take notice. And it's going to cite a bunch of legal provisions, statutes. You can scroll down, Jakari. Right. So keep going. So here, this is a notice that's, you know, remember when I told you about nuisance? Let's say you're paying loud music. This is what the notice is supposed to look like. It's supposed to give you specific dates and times and details to tell you why the landlord says you're a bad tenant. Right. You're bothering other tenants. This is the notice of cure, right? They're saying, hey, this is all. I have notice of this. You can keep going, Jakari. Stop it or else. Okay. Yeah, go on to the next. Let's do the next. But I just want to let you all know, like, don't worry about reading this carefully. This is for you to visually connect, right? I talked a lot about these terms. I want you to see them on the paper and get a general idea. Sometimes they look slightly different, but a lot of them are kind of, you know, there are general ways they look. And so these are examples for you so you can, it can connect if unfortunately you're in this situation. This is what I told you about. This is the lawsuit. It's called the petition. So this says holdover petition, all right? That's what it looks like. And it's based on that notice to cure I just showed you. It means they're alleging this person did not fix the behavior within 10 days. So now I'm suing to evict them. All right, you can scroll down, Jakari. So you saw how that looks. Oh yeah. And so you can stop here. And this is what I tell you. It's the notice of petition. Those come together, petition and notice of petition. Together, they make the lawsuit. All right. And just look at the top of that page. That's kind of important for to kind of, you know, get your alarm bells ringing. You see, that's what's called the caption, right? It has your landlord who's suing you as the petitioner. And then you're listed as what's called the respondent in the lawsuit. All right. and you see how that looks, right? Notice petition holdover, civil court of the city of New York, housing part, right? So just giving you an idea. You can keep going, Jakari. Yeah. Oh, stop. Oh, sorry. Can you go back up just a little bit? Go up, rip up a little more. Stop. All right. So here, this one is, you know, right under those black boxes, it says, please take notice. That will have the date. Remember I told you in a holdover, it will come filled in with that date if it's a holdover, just so you know, okay? It gives you the date and time and where to go for your court case. All right, keep going, Jakari. Okay, so here's a holdover, failure to renew. Yeah, scroll down. Stop there. So remember, I told you the other type, I just want to give you eyes on the different terms I used. So remember, two types of cases, non-payment, holdover. And sorry, I keep repeating it, but this helps to remember, I promise you. Two types of cases, non-payment and holdover. And then I broke holdover down with three different types of predicate notice, right? We just looked at notice to cure. Here is what's called a notice of termination, all right? A notice of termination, a lot of times is that's what you'll see often with rent regulated tenants, rent that are rent stabilized or rent controlled, because if you're rent regulated, you have the right to stay in your apartment as long as you want, okay? And you can renew every time the lease expires, unless the landlord evicts you for certain reasons, right? That's why they call it notice of termination. You have the right to stay in your apartment, but they're terminating that right. Okay. Other types of people who will see notice of termination is even if you're not rent regulated, if your lease is still in effect, that means you have a right to be in the apartment, but the landlord is trying to cut that right short. So you'll see the notice of termination oftentimes. All right. You can keep going. Keep going. So here's an affidavit of service. We are definitely not getting into this technical complexity and all this stuff, but remember when I told you about technical issues? This is one of the documents that a lawyer will assess. And if you know enough, you can assess yourself, okay? Just see if service was proper, right? Because they have to put information like when they came to your apartment, what date, what time, and then they're gonna say, oh, they didn't answer. So you can see if that stuff's true. All right, we can pass this. There's another one, it says holdover petition. You saw it, notice of petition, all right? Keep going. That's another affidavit of service. Just know that. Keep going. All right. Keep going. Yeah, scroll past this too, please. Keep going there. All right, keep going. So again, I hope you all are seeing that the petitions generally will start looking the same. They have that block at the top, what's called the caption, right? With the parties and the court. And, you know, so here's just another example. But again, you all are seeing the pattern and how they kind of look, right? Like it's not, everyone's not going to be the same and identical, but they have general looks to them. And remember, all of these notices give you the opportunity. They give you a deadline to fix something that the landlord says you're doing wrong, or else they're going to start the case. All right, keep going, please. Yeah, scroll past that. All right, boom. Here's our other type of case, non-payment. You see, still looks the same, right? It's got the same core caption, but yep, right where Jakari is circling, it says non-payment petition instead of holdover, okay? And this one's different because you see number two down there in the middle of the page where Jakari's at, it's telling you how much they're alleging you owe, a money judgment for this much money. You know, they're saying you owe that rent, okay? All right, you can keep scrolling. Stop here. So here's the petition for a non-payment. Okay. Once again, you know, these are different. Instead of saying that here are the things that you're doing wrong, this is all about money, right? So now the petition is going to have numbers. It's supposed to list the months, as you can see down there, number six. It says this is the total they owe, and here's it, and here it is broken down, right? December 2021, this person allegedly did not pay that amount. Right. And they're saying we have a lease agreement for that amount. They didn't pay it. All right. So this is what a petition looks like for a non-payment. And you can go on, Jakari. Some more. Stop. Yeah, and here we go. So this is, remember again, predicate notice. So this is the predicate notice for a non-payment case. So this is the what I told you before, 14-day notice, right? Ever since June 2019, tenants get 14 days. What the 14-day notice is supposed to have, what they also call the rent demand, is it's a simple document. You see it right there. They're supposed to say, list the specific months and the amounts that you failed to pay, right? A lot of you may know, a lot of this stuff is just, they're not verifying it. They're just rolling it out to get you sued. Because if you can see there in April 2021, at the bottom of that list of months, what did they do? They just basically go back in time, you know, from it right now is March, right? So they'll say, oh, February, January, December, they just start going backwards. Oh, he didn't pay, you know, the full rent amount. And then there's going to be a leftover 1 month. So this is another document that people should pay attention to, because remember, the point of the 14-day notice is to give you a chance to pay the debt before they sue you for eviction for non-payment. Okay. But this is the famous 14-day notice, or infamous, if you will. Keep going. Keep going. So last thing I wanted to show you, here's a notice. Yep. So here is a postcard version of it. And if you scroll up, Jakari, they also do these letters like that look like this, right? The court sends it to you. I just want to let you know, if you receive something like this, this comes from the court and it's just notifying you of a court date that you have. All right. So this does not come from the landlord, doesn't come from anyone. This comes from the court, all right? They're just trying to let you know. So it's a reminder, all right? And like the other one Jakari showed us is a postcard. See that one there too? People may have gotten that. So it could come in either form, all right? But it's just letting you know. But do not count on the court to send them, because the court is still not the most efficient bureaucracy. They do a lot of these notices, but they don't always, but it's still just another chance that gives you an opportunity to, know what's going on. All right. And definitely heed it. If you do get one, even if you got no other papers, this is important. If you got no other papers and had no idea there was a case against you, if you see that postcard or letter from the court, yes, go on that court date. Okay. Because it means there is a court date, even if there's not supposed to be. Right? So you need to be able to explain stuff to the judge. Okay. That's it. Q&A time. I hope I left at least enough for a little here. So. Okay.
Yeah. So thank you, Jeremiah, for that. So we do have quite a few questions that have come in over the course of you presenting. Okay. So I'm going to start with the first question that came in. It says, are tenants protected who have city FEPs?
So the answer is yes and no. The no is that just because you have city FEPs, even though you qualified, right? So a lot of you, if the person who's asking the question probably knows this too, you have to qualify to be able to get city FEPs. And for those who don't know what it is, city FEPs is a subsidy by the city, all right, which means rental assistance. Every month, the city will pay a big portion, a majority of your rent. Oftentimes, I don't know if it's still a majority, but they pay a portion of your rent every month and the tenant pays the rest. Okay. That just because you have that, it does not give you extra eviction protections. It does not. Okay. So that's the no part of it. Right. The yes. The reason why I said yes as well is, even though the no is the technical legal answer, no, you don't have additional protections, but the yes is the practical side, right? It's the real world stuff. You know, you can, the city, because they've been pumping money, helping you, like, you know, sometimes there's an issue with the city sending the money, or sometimes the tenant fell behind because they had to pay for a funeral for a close family member. The city's been investing this money in you. They don't want to see you evicted. You know, that's taxpayer money helping you stay in the apartment, only to see you get evicted. That's not a good look, right? So the practical side of why I say yes is, you have a city agency there who is interested in keeping you there. So if it comes down to just paying the money, then you have a good, better chance as a practical matter of being able to settle the case, promise to pay something in the future, and the city can help you, right?
Thank you. The next question is, how do I respond to clerk when I receive non-payment?
So the way you respond is, I'm sure most of you are probably in Manhattan, I'll use Manhattan, but you have to go to the housing court in your county, right? Wherever you all are. And it will be in the papers too. It'll say, you must go down to the clerk of the city, you know, the county of whatever, you know, this housing court at this address to answer within 10 days. Okay. It will give you that information. But just for those of you who are in Manhattan, that is at 111 Center Street. All right. That's where the housing court is. And that's where the clerk is, where you file your answer. Okay. So that's on the second floor of 111 Center Street. What you need to do is bring a copy of the court papers that you received, bring your photo ID, right, and you go to the second floor, and then you will give an oral answer to the clerk, and they will record it and put it in a computer, like a generated answer form, right? So just tell them as much as you can, whatever your defenses are, and the clerk's supposed to put that in, and that's what will generate your answer and your first court date.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so the next question is in Spanish. So if you are listening, if you are English speaking, I do ask you click on the globe at the bottom so you can actually hear the interpretation in English. The globe that says interpretation, click on your appropriate language. So if you're English, click on English. If you're Spanish, click on Spanish. So I'll have Daniel do the translation.
So I will give some general information here. Unfortunately, I can't get into too many specifics because that could be a legal consultation by itself. All right. So please, Jakari, should they just contact?
Yeah, they should definitely just call our office.
Okay.
To follow up. Yeah.
Thank you. So Austin, please call our office to follow up so we can talk specifically about your issue. But let me give some general words for people listening. ERAP has a whole bunch of rules attached to it when it comes to landlords accepting ERAP. It's also interesting that your landlord would reject it because landlords are part of the ERAP process. But anyway, that being said, if you have issues with ERAP and you can't get it resolved with your landlord or with the state reps, if you unfortunately find yourself in a non-payment case because of the issues that Augustine just raised, you must inform the court of this. Okay. If the landlord's attorney is also going to take the same position as the landlord and suddenly, you know, turn around and try to make it difficult for you, you know, when they have money waiting for them, right? Isn't it? It's about payment. Why aren't they accepting the money? Right. There could be more going on. But what you need to do is raise those issues with the court. And the court, I can tell you, will handle them, okay? Once they know that that's the case, also that you have a disability, the court will take those things into account and they'll deal with it, right? So you should definitely bring it up if there's a court case. All right.
The next question is relating back to City FEPS. This is the same person who asked the first one. It says, if City FEPS HRA has been paying full rent and there's an issue with renewing the voucher, can the tenant be evicted for non-paying rent?
It depends, but yes. I mean, it depends on why there's an issue with renewing the voucher. I mean, there has been, for example, right? I know that there's a lot of issues right now in the city, okay? With right to counsel, right? Legal services provider, short staffing, but also HRA. And I know about slowdowns, okay, and processing the applications, right? I know that there's different things that are being done to try to fix that, but the unfortunate reality is, yes, you could still face the eviction process for the failure for it to be recertified. Okay, so funny enough, the person who's asking the same question, I again have a sort of like technical answer and practical. So yes, technically you can face an eviction process. They have the right to sue you for non-payment, even if it's not your fault and it's the city's fault, because the lease contract is between you and the landlord. You promise to pay a certain amount, and every month, and the landlord promises to make repairs. That's a contract, right? So they do have the right to sue you, even if it's not your fault. That's the unfortunate, tough legal reality. But the practical answer again is the courts take this into consideration, all right? And there's different things that can be done to try to prolong or settle the process, or even motions that may be able to be made to try to get more time or get certain things dismissed. There are arguments that can be made in court, and as a practical matter, a judge would be pretty sympathetic. If you submitted everything on time, you already have city FABs, you have other facts that may be good facts, like you have young children or whatever the case may be, the judge is going to be most often is going to be sympathetic to you, okay? Because they're going to be like, look, this person already had city FABs, nothing's changed, they submitted everything on time, it's not the tenant's fault, right? So you may be able to as a practical matter, work certain things out or even present certain legal defenses, okay?
The next question is, my landlord is taking me to court, but I pay rent and have receipts. I don't have an attorney. So I'm guessing they're asking, where they should go, if they've been paying the rent, they have collected all their receipts, but I guess they're being taken to court, I'm guessing for non-payment. What should they do?
Right. So what I would tell you is, first, you should try to talk to the landlord, show them all your proof, right? But here's what I recommend. And any lawyer worth their salt will probably tell you this. Try to do things so that there's a paper trail. So what I would advise is writing an email, okay? I know that sometimes landlords or management companies try to make it hard. They may not give you emails, okay? So all that aside, most management companies and landlords will have emails. You can contact them, right? So you can create a paper trail. If you don't do email, hopefully someone can help you. But my suggestion is write an email saying, hey, I received these court papers. You say I owe this money, but I paid the months. I attached the rent receipts, I hope that this will resolve the issue. And can you please promise me that there will not be a court case and that this is resolved, right? I would create that paper trail. They may not answer you, but there's now proof of that, right? So try to get it done with the landlord. If for whatever reason, there's no way you can do email, then go in person, but try to keep records as much as you can. Try to get some sort of written record of your visit with a landlord, but show them the proof, try to avoid it. Then if you unfortunately still get taken to court, you will bring those receipts to court, and the judge and the judge's personnel, their staff, can help you with that case. I mean, look, if you paid the rent, you're good, honestly. I mean, you shouldn't have to go through the stress of a court case, 100%, but that's a case that you should win if you really have those proofs, So, even the most landlord friendly judge is going to dismiss a case if you have adequate proof. Right.
Okay. The next question, my landlord failed to show up in court, case dismissed. Mm-hmm. However, I obtained counsel from Mobilization for Justice and initiated an HP action for repairs. And a stipulation has not been addressed. The attorneys at that organization have not proceeded with my HP action as requested. Should I contact the Bar Association to move forward with my HP case?
So what I would say here, so first general principles, you as the client, you have a right to know what's going on with your case and good communication, okay? you know, which is different from sometimes you don't like what you hear. That's different. You know, sometimes there's harsh realities in courts, but for better or worse, you should know what's going on, right? You should know what's going on. You should know the reasons why there isn't a settlement. What are the reasons why nothing has moved forward, right? You are entitled to those concrete reasons. If you don't have those answers and you've given your attorney every opportunity to answer you, right? You've contacted them many times. They're not doing it, contacting you back. What I would suggest is going up the ladder. Contact their supervisor, call the office, ask to speak with their direct supervisor or with the attorney in charge of the office. I have seen people get, you know, just that practical advice sometimes gets the ball moving, right? Or, you know, so that you can understand what's going on or get your attorney to answer you. You know, at the end of the day, you know, contacting the Bar Association, I mean, I'm not sure exactly, you know, there are different sort of parts of what it means, the Bar Association, but I don't think that's really going to help you in any way. Even if you file a complaint with the, you know, the New York State Bar, which is, you know, different from the Bar Association, but, you know, that's not going to practically help you move your HP case forward. You could just get the attorney disciplined if the bar wants to discipline them. So what I would suggest is take it up the ladder, try to speak with their supervisor. If things are really bad, and it doesn't even work when you climb up the flagpole, right, and go up the ladder, then you have the right to go to court. If you're in Manhattan, remember, I gave you the address and where to go. You have the right to go to court and file what is called an order to show cause. You will hear it called, shortened to OSC a lot, OSC, order to show cause. You go to that same place, you go to a clerk's office, you say, hey, I have a housing court case. Here's the index number. Here's my ID. I am not satisfied with my attorney. I want to get in front of the judge. So, you know, can I file an OSC? It will be an OSC to relieve your attorney, which basically means to fire them. Okay. It doesn't mean they're automatically fired, but what this does is it puts the case on the court calendar to get in front of the judge. So then you can talk to the judge. Okay. You know, the attorney could stay on. Maybe the judge talks and says, hey, do you want them to keep representing you? Maybe you're like, yes, but I just want more communication, right? Or something like that. The judge will talk to them and sometimes it gets resolved that way. Okay. So if all else fails, go to court, show them the index number to the clerk, your photo ID, say, I need to file an OSC, you know, to ask the judge to relieve my attorney. All right. It doesn't have to happen, like I said, but it can help you get things moving. Or if you aren't satisfied at the end of the day, you could always ask the judge to, you know, end the current, the attorney client relationship between you and the attorney. Right.
Next question. My building has one elevator that has been out of service for 6 weeks. The DOB came out and a fine was issued. What can the tenants do if the building is part of the alternative program for repairs? The owners have not paid for the repairs and they will not return to make the repairs. What can the seniors do that are walking up 7 floors?
So this is, I'm assuming the person is talking about what's called AEP, the Alternative Enforcement Program. That's a special program in HPD where the worst landlords, which is rated by how many violations they have, right, in the building, they can be placed in HPD's Alternative Enforcement Program, AEP. The problem is AEP is a great idea on paper, but has been notorious in being really poor at making sure these worst buildings get the repairs they deserve, right? And it's unfortunate because I will still tell you to do this. You should still make sure everyone should flood 311 with building complaints, with condition complaints, so that inspectors come and violations get placed. You should still do it, even though AEP gets special inspectors, unfortunately. So this is part of why the program isn't running like it's supposed to, but you should still do it. So there's that record of that. And, but if it's not working out, then my suggestion is organizing together and suing the landlord for repairs. That is in housing court, and that's what's called an HP case, HP action, or HP proceeding. But it's called an HP. That's where the tenants sue the landlords for repairs. And if you do it as a group, that's even better. So that way the courts got eyes on it. Then you can get deadlines for repairs to get done. You can figure out these issues, you know, and then if they don't do it, the court can punish them for failing to do, you know, fix the things on time. So that's what I would suggest. A lot of complaints, but eventually also talk amongst yourself. See if you, you know, it's everyone's better if you band together. See if you can file that type of case. But you should also, you know, blow up your, you know, really contact also your local elected officials and state officials and just annoy them. Like, organize that way, starting, you know, first before even suing. Just try to do it, all these steps to escalate and put pressure on. And then if all else fails, you can start that court case.
Mm-hmm. Right. The next question, and I'm just asking everybody to be patient because tonight we have a lot of questions tonight. So if you ask the question, just stick around because I'm going in order. The next question is, if I'm in court because my daughter lives in the apartment, however, I didn't let the landlord know I moved. Now they are starting a holdover. My daughter lived with me for a long time. How do I stop this court? How do I stop this in court?
So this is another thing where if people have specific questions on a court case, because every case has to be analyzed on its own facts and merits. You know, I'm not going to be able to talk very detailed here, but I'm going to, again, just like the last time, give some general things that people should know. One is, if you have a rent regulated apartment, which means rent controlled or rent stabilized, there is something called succession rights. That's where certain family members, and even if you're not a family member, if you're like a family member, they can take over the lease in their own name when the tenant moves out, all right? But the person has to have lived there with the tenant for at least 2 years before the tenant moved out, right? And it has to be, you know, it can't be like 2 years a long time ago. It has to be the 2 years immediately prior to when the tenant moved out, the family member or the family-like member has to have been there for at least 2 years at that time, okay? It's 1 year if they're disabled or over 62, but usually at least 2 years, all right? That's called succession rights in a rent-regulated apartment, right? That's a whole issue. I mean, Jesse Gribben from Himmelstein McConnell, one of our great friends, Tapalante, he gave a whole webinar just on succession rights, okay? So I can't get into it here, but you know, you should know that those exist if you have a rent-regulated apartment, and you may have to fight for them. You know, you can try just talking it out with the landlord, proving this is my daughter, and look, she's lived here. You know, they might give you the lease, but normally a lot of landlords see what they can get away with, even if they think you're telling the truth. So unfortunately, you may have to prove in court, right? If you do not have a rent-regulated apartment, then the child, it doesn't matter if they grew up there their whole lives, they may not have the right to stay there, okay? So it is very vital on the type of apartment you live in to know whether your daughter has the right to stay there or not, okay? And just so you know, NYCHA Public Housing, and then also Section 8 housing, they have their own rules as well for succession. All right.
Okay. So the next question is in Spanish, so I will have Daniel interpret. Okay, so if that's Agustin from earlier, please just contact Palante on Monday, okay? So we can help you out. Answered that one already? Okay. Oh, yeah, you can do that one too, okay. No, I'm talking about the ERAB one in Spanish. Yes. Does E then?
I don't understand.
Okay. I'm gonna need them to elaborate on that question.
Yeah, we have to be in the middle.
Yeah. And Jeremiah addressed ERAPs earlier. So the next question is, my landlord has not given me a lease in years, so I stopped paying rent. Can I do this?
So yes, you can do it. And there are certain technical defenses. You know, if they don't, again, let me be clear that a lot of these questions depend on the type of apartment you have. If you're rent regulated, Section 8, market, okay? So again, if there are specific legal issues, folks should also, you know, contact Palante as far as if we need to delve deeper into issues. But just for the general information with this question, you can, you know, there is no contract, there's no lease, right? So technically you don't have that with the landlord. So there are certain defenses and counterclaims. And again, depending on your type of housing, it could change that. But I want to warn folks that there is a thing called use and occupancy as well. It's a legal term, which means you have been able to use and occupy the apartment, right? So you have the benefit of living in the apartment. So, you know, this concept means you should pay the fair use of it. And what that usually means is whatever the last lease rate was. So, you know, this is kind of the double-edged sword too, is if they haven't been giving you, for example, in a rent-regulated housing apartment, if they haven't been properly offering you renewal leases, then, you know, you may be on the hook for paying all the months since then, but you have an argument that it should be only at the last lease amount, right? They can't do increases since they haven't given you a new lease. So there's things you can work with, but generally speaking, the courts, and also as a practical matter, you know, the judges are going to think if you've had the benefit of living in the apartment, you know, almost all judges think you should pay something for it.
Okay. I have noisy neighbors. What do I do? I told landlord, make several complaints for years, call 311. I need help.
Okay. So let me be I got to tell you, this is one of the worst questions because I hate the reality, because there is no perfect solution. I unfortunately have to just say that from the beginning. I've been dealing with these noise neighbor against neighbor noises issues for like 11, 12 years now. And it's still, there's no real good reason. I'm sorry, but especially because of the way you said that you've made these complaints to the landlord and the landlord's not doing anything, right? That's what makes it the worst situation, okay? Because the landlord has, as I'm sure you know, because I gave this as an example in my talk, the landlord has the right to start a holdover eviction case. That's called a nuisance case, right? You are being a nuisance to everybody, to your neighbors, blasting this music at inappropriate hours or all hours of the day, right? The landlord has the right to start that case and should, particularly when you've given all these complaints, okay? But if the landlord doesn't, what do you have as alternatives? There, again, these are where it gets really imperfect, to say the least. I mean, these are not even great alternatives, but this is what there is. Sometimes folks, believe it or not, are successful doing mediation. Sometimes you can get, there are organizations in New York City that specialize in mediation, have been doing it for many years, even though it's not a legal process. Sometimes if parties come to the table to mediate, there can be solutions, right? Landlords can agree, for example, to at least insulate or, you know, make it more soundproof. So there's something called mediation. The other very imperfect solution is you may be able to sue your neighbor directly in Supreme Court, in New York State Supreme Court, for different things like emotional distress, you know, lost wages if maybe you get sick from not being able to sleep because of the noise. You know, there's claims you can do, but that you know, usually requires an attorney. So this is why it's not perfect. But, you know, what I would suggest to you is if you have other neighbors that are also bothered by this, I would suggest there's always strength in numbers, especially when we talk about landlords and tenants in New York City, because there's so much power on the landlord side. So if you can get as many neighbors as possible to create it, you probably already have this, but if you already created it, to add to the paper trail and the proof of all the complaints. Okay. So you can, you know, I would do that as well. And maybe just try to mount more pressure. And again, I would make the same suggestion to you, reach out to your elected officials and make as many of your neighbors, have them reach out and pressure them. And when you call the elected, call them again the next week. And then again, and then again, like just mount pressure, because a lot of people call these offices, but if there's enough bugging and there's, you know, the strength in numbers, sometimes it will make them take action. And you never know if some landlords, I'm going to be honest, they don't care one bit who tries to pressure them. They're just like that. But a lot of landlords may respond to pressure. If your elected representative is bugging them and saying, do you know how many complaints I'm getting? And they said they have proof, they've been notifying you and you're not doing anything. Can you tell me what's going on here? Sometimes that can be enough to make the landlord finally take action, maybe sue to evict the tenant or something like that. Okay.
The next question is, in a non-payment, non-rent regulated, I made a payment for a portion of the rent. The landlord held the certified check and did not cash it. Is it better to continue to make payments to avoid late fees and penalties, or withhold further payments?
So this is, what type of housing is this again?
It says non-rent regulated. So
is it market? Maybe, I mean, it could still have some subsidy, but if it's non-rent regulated, it's market. I mean, look, this is a specific case question, right? I can't get too much into it here. So I'm not going to tell you right now whether you should keep paying or you should hold the rent, because it's going to depend on more than just this quick question, honestly. It wouldn't be responsible for me to tell you yes or no over this platform.
But he lives in a co-op.
Oh, that's also different. See, this is why it's like very specific situations. Yeah. But are you renting? See, I'm sorry, I can't get into
just it. Yeah.
There's a lot of facts that just swirl through my head. We're not brushing you off. It's just that literally there's so many things that could influence the advice here. Okay. So yeah, just call us.
Okay. This says, you mentioned settlement agreements and non-payments may have consequences if we fail to pay in the future. I was funded by ERAB last year for nearly all rent arrears. However, I fell behind due to lack of employment. I did pay as much as possible. However, I began to accrue arrears, and now management company is indicating I need to settle up or they will begin eviction process. Does my failure to pay some months since ERAB funding bypass ERAB's rules moving forward?
No, so you can still be sued for failing to pay. It doesn't mean you can't pay. So ERAB does have some prohibitions. If the landlord accepts ERAB payments, there are certain reasons the landlord cannot sue you for eviction. But if you fall right behind again in rent, the landlord could sue you for non-payment. So, you know, it is an issue. It is an issue. They could sue you.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, like I understand people hit hard times in their situation. So, you know, you'll have to do the best you can, you know, depending on your defenses and what income you have on the horizon, you know. But, you know, you should also never enter into any, you know, you can make an agreement now, but if you're in court with a non-payment, you know, I really advise people generally only make agreements where you promise to pay if you really think you can get that money.
Right. Yeah. So the person who asked that question followed up with a few more, you know, a few more descriptive details about it. But since, you know, we do have a lot of questions, I have to get to everyone. Please, the person who asked that question with the and you had the follow-ups, just call Palante on Monday. Okay. Okay, Daniel, we have another question in Spanish.
You have to send proof of your pay. You have to have proof of your payment, and you're going to have to raise that in court. Tell the judge or the judge's court attorney on the very first. Well, first, yeah, you tell them on the first day that you're in court. You show them proof. Look, I sent payments, but it's not my fault. They're not cashing it. So that's what you need to do. Have your proof and see if the court can help you resolve it.
Okay. The next question is, my landlord left the court papers taped to my door. Does this fall under they didn't serve me right?
Not necessarily. It could be proper. So it depends on the facts. There are a lot of technical legal requirements. So when you get the papers taped on your door, that means that the person was unsuccessful in serving you personally, right, in person, on two different attempts. Right? So this is circling back to what I presented before. So they have to, you know, and if they were unsuccessful twice in handing you the papers in person, then there are other ways they can do it. And part of that is by taping it on your door, but they also have to mail you copies. So you have to get certified and regular mail copies as well. So again, it can get very technical. You would have to look in your specific case, you would have to go over it with an attorney, or, you know, get some advice on it, or even go over it with the court, right? But you have to look at that affidavit of service, see if it's true. When they say they made the two attempts to serve you, is there something that's obviously false to you? For example, you might know it says on Friday, you know, January 5th, 2023 at 3:30 p.m. I tried to serve it personally and no one answered. You might know that that is 100% false because you had your daughter's birthday party on that day and you had a lot of guests, so you were answering the door constantly, so no one came. Right? Look at those things. Look at when they say they tried to serve you, because remember, the law prefers in-person service and they have to try twice before doing a service, right? So look at that. But
okay. It says, what happens when a tenant is harassing everyone in a building with harm, is in court but has not been evicted even if the papers were served?
So there's a lot of things here. One is, if people feel comfortable doing it, if these are serious threats, you can always contact the police and file police reports. And if, again, power in numbers, if a lot of you are doing it, that can escalate the situation. But the other side of your question is, you said they're in court but has not been evicted yet. Again, that depends on specific facts. Are they in court for harassing people, right? Is that the reason they're in court? If so, then you have to let that process play out, because there's a whole legal process. The tenant has the right to go through the court process. They have to, you know, agree to move out or lose a trial. And then after, if they still stay in the building, then the landlord has to serve a marshal's notice. The marshals have to come and lock them out. So there's a process, okay? So the second part of the question, if that person's in court for doing what they're doing, let the process play out, okay? I don't know how long it'll take. It depends on the specific facts. But if the person is in court for a different reason, not for being a nuisance, not for harassing the other tenants, then you all have to really do everything in your power to try to put the pressure on the landlord to evict the person for harassing you all. right? And I went over that earlier. And then I also just threw into the mix, if you all feel comfortable, as a group, also making a bunch of police reports, because that can add pressure and, you know, and your elected officials, things like that.
The next question, why don't the management companies contact tenants through phone calls or emails to discuss these issues before they go to the court?
Well, the law requires it in writing. Mm-hmm. Yeah, by like they have to like mail it or hand it to you. So, I mean, it's not a legal requirement that they do that. It'd be nice. I mean, you know, I think they should try to do everything they can to help a tenant out or avoid legal courts, but there's no requirement to do that.
Right. Okay. So the next question is in Spanish. So Daniel, can you interpret that for us?
Okay, so contact Belante. You're going to be another person. Jakari, get ready for Monday, man. So please do contact Belante. But again, I try to give some general things, right? First, you have the right to do what you did. Maybe you all have heard this before. If you've known me for any amount of time, you're going to be like, I heard you say that. But I like to explain it this way. And it's another thing that shows how even when housing law is very complex, right? Because it is in New York City, but there's a lot of concepts that at the end of the day are very basic, right? What is a landlord-tenant relationship? What is a lease, right? At the end of the day, it's a simple two-way contract. The tenant agrees that in exchange for letting me live here, I will pay you every month this amount of money, right? The landlord in return agrees that as long as you're the tenant, I will keep the building and the apartment in good repair, in good conditions. It will be habitable, right? At the end of the day, that's the basic, most basic contract when it comes to leases, right? So the law allows you, you know, you're sitting there, you're paying your rent, and the landlord's not fixing. So you're doing your end of the bargain, but they're not doing theirs, right? So the law allows you to do what you did. You have the right to stop rent payments, to withhold rent, to force the landlord to make repairs, right? However, this is another example where the law is a little bit very imperfect. The landlord can still sue you for non-payment, okay? Even though you have the right to withhold your rent payments, the landlord can sue you still. But here's the good news. One is make sure you save all the money you withheld. You have to save every penny. Don't spend it, right? And as long as you do that, then you're going to have a very strong position in court, okay? The landlord's allowed to sue you for non-payment, but remember that answer I told you about? You're going to put in your answer all the things, the repairs that are not getting done. I have the money, but I withheld it because the landlord has put me through so much. You're going to bring that up. And you can use that to force the landlord to make the repairs. And you may even be able to get what is called a rent abatement. That's a discount in the amount of rent that you owe because you've had to live with these conditions. Okay. So that's the general advice, right? The follow-up, as far as you say, I don't have a lawyer. Yeah, I understand. It can be difficult to negotiate these settlements and these things. If you don't have a lawyer, obviously, I know you're going to call Palante, but you know, you could always on the first day also ask the court. If Palante doesn't take your case, for example, or whatever happens, Palante is not your lawyer, then on the first court date, remember, you can always ask for an adjournment to get another court date so that you can look for a lawyer. And you can also say on the first court date, you can ask the judge to refer you to a free lawyer. Okay, so if it's not Palante, they can refer you to some other organizations who will contact you before your next court date. Okay. Now, lastly, worst case scenario, if no one takes your case, try to use the court as much as possible. Use the judge and use the judge's attorney. They call them the court attorney, and say, I have every penny. It's not about the money. Like, I just want the repairs I deserve. Get the court to help you get deadlines, get the repairs, but tell them, I think I should also get a discount because of what I've been good on my end, but they've been not been good on their end. You can get the court to try to help you to get some discount too on the amount that's owed.
Okay. The next question is, I live in a rent stabilized apartment in the Bronx, and I lived there with my daughters and wife for years. And the new landlords took over in 2019. A non-payment eviction notice was taped in the building by the mailboxes for all tenants to see, stating that I owed 2 months. I was not served an affidavit like you explained. However, I did pay the rent and I told them I am being harassed because the non-payment was posted in the building.
Mm-hmm. So that is not proper. They should not have taped it there, okay? So you're right about that. So there's two issues here. Well, I know you said you paid the rent, but if there were a non-payment case, you can bring up improper service. That's one of those technical defenses, you know? You may not always pursue a technical defense if it does, you know, if you just want to get the case over with or whatever, but it is available. So, well, again, technical defense. But and also, not only that, but if there were a non-payment, you could also raise a harassment counterclaim. You could say, because of this, I want you to penalize the landlord. You know, under the law, there are certain penalties, monetary penalties, money penalties that can be against the landlord, or small monetary penalties that can be paid to the tenant as damages. Okay. So that's if you have a non-pay. You know, you can also start an HP action for harassment using this as proof of how they harass you. But you may also, just as a practical advice, if you did that, I would also suggest maybe having some other actions that you could call harassment, like failure to make repairs or other conduct, right? But yeah, so that's that.
Okay. Next question. My dad was the primary tenant on lease, but I was living with him together due to his sickness, and he passed away a few years ago. I'm unemployed, can't pay the rent, and he has severe, and he was served a non-payment. As a result, I answered to the court and explained that my dad has an active ERAP case under my name because my dad is deceased. Now the judge verified my ERAP. Okay, so I think it's just asking more about like the ERAP protection. I think, so I would say definitely just call us on Monday because I'm seeing it's a lot about ERAP, and we did do a lot of ERAP, and we're well-versed in that. So just give us a call on Monday and so we can further assist that. My landlord is a known investor. They have a master key to the building mailboxes and have literally removed legal notices and legal documents from my mailbox. This is harassment and retaliation, but I can't afford a lawyer to file harassment suits. Even if I'm available to keep my permit, how can I find a lawyer to take our harassment case?
It is extremely difficult unless you can pay. That's just the unfortunate reality, because there's not really much free legal services for harassment only sort of cases. I would say though that you should know that, again, the housing court is designed, even though it's still complicated, I know, but it's less complicated. It's designed to be a lot less complicated than other courts for people who are unrepresented. So a lot of people start HP cases for repairs and harassment against their landlord on their own. It's very common. The court is well versed in dealing with unrepresented people. Okay. They call them pro se litigants. That's the technical term. Pro se litigant means unrepresented party. Mm-hmm. So what I would suggest is, unfortunately, that the reality is if you can't afford an attorney, it's going to be very tough too. So you should start, you can start your own case and see what you can do in housing court. The other, but make sure you have proof of this stuff. You know, I believe what you're saying, but the court's going to need more than you just saying it or arguing why it's the case. They're going to really want to see proof of that.
Okay, next question. I had washing machines for years in my apartment. A new landlord took over. Can they tell me to remove the washing machines, even though I had it since 2009?
If your lease permits it, they can't tell you to. If you're a rent-stabilized tenant and you've had that in your lease, then no. But again, look, it depends on your type of housing. Once again, like I say, a lot of these questions that ask specifics, remember, different rules apply to different types of housing. But there is often depending on the specific facts, you may be able to make an argument that the new landlord cannot force you to do that. Okay. Also, if you have proof that the old landlord allowed that to happen, actually had knowledge and still didn't care, you know, maybe you have another argument that can be made. But it can very much boil down to what type of housing you have and what your original lease says, and maybe any lease renewals or other sort of documentation or proof of having a washing machine. It also could matter if other people have washing machines too, and they're allowed to, because then you might have certain arguments about being singled out. So yeah, I mean, that's sort of some of the general stuff to let you all know. Okay. But that's also specific. Yeah. Case. Okay.
If my management company has previously overcharged me for rent, but DHCR refused to take into account the year the overcharge happened and is now overcharging based on ERAB rules, does that have any leverage or additional consequences for management?
There are different, the term overcharge was used in a couple of different contexts here. I think you can have overcharges for different reasons. And if it's rent regulated housing, which I presume it is, because the person who asked was talking about DHCR ignoring rent overcharge or not taking into account, an overcharge. So, there are different types of rules. So there are different types of overcharges, but it is true that under ERAP, there are rules about not agreeing not to raise the rent. So what you could have is an argument, if there's a non-payment, you could argue that the landlord is seeking more rent than they're entitled to. You could do that, you could have that defense in a non-payment.
Okay. My sister is under rent control. She was taken to court for non-payment. Listening to you, she was not served correctly. And today her counselor told her that she needs to turn over the apartment. We had this apartment for 66 years. I would like to meet you at your office. So for that person, please give us a call one Monday.
Yes. Okay. Please do, but let me add this. This is the sort of lawyer ethical thing.
Okay.
Since you are represented by someone currently, the law prohibits me, the code of ethics in New York, I'm not allowed to give you legal advice. Mm-hmm. So that's unfortunate, but I will say some general things here. I did say them earlier, some of this earlier, but it's important to repeat so people know. You have the right to be satisfied with your attorney. Okay. There are a lot of attorneys who don't do a good job, or they don't communicate well with their clients, or they don't even do the best for their clients. I know that. Okay. But then there are also, clients who are maybe asking for unreasonable things, which, by the way, I am not saying that's what you're doing. I know you've been there 66 years, but I'm just saying generally, sometimes tenants want things that the law does not allow. And, you know, like I said, but the lawyer should still be communicating that to you and explaining that, right? So the lawyer needs to make very clear, if this is your home of 66 years, you better know damn sure why it is that you have to move out according to your lawyer, okay? So these are general baselines. Like, you really should be able to feel comfortable. If you don't, you can ask the court, like I said, just like with the other person, you can file a motion. Remember, it's called, it's, and it's simple. It's not complicated. You go to the clerk's office. You can file an order to show cause. And remember, they call it OSC a lot in court. You can file an OSC to relieve your counsel. And that can at least strategically give you the opportunity to talk to the judge directly and say, this is what my lawyer is telling me, but why? Why would I have to do that? I don't, it doesn't feel right to me, right? You can talk about that. So that's, you know, that's what I would, and then at the end of the day, if for whatever reason you all can't continue the relationship, then you could relieve them, which means fire your attorney, you know. After that point, then you can talk to other attorneys and they can advise you all they want. But I, unfortunately, even if you met with me, I wouldn't be able to talk about the substance of your case since you're represented. I can only give that sort of general stuff. So, you know, please do pursue those avenues. Oh, but remember, before you do all that, remember what I said before too, escalate it up the ladder too. If you're feeling like this same thing seems off, get a supervisor to verify and explain to you why it is that you supposedly have to leave after 66 years, you know, you should be able to understand that. So start there, start with climbing up the ladder, supervise, you know, supervisor. And after that, you know, if you have to, you can file that OSC, but get the court to and judge to personally tell you so that you can see whether what's happening is legitimate or not.
Does the preferential rent law put in place in 2019 apply to preferential rent given at any time prior to 2019, but no longer continued?
Okay, great question. Great question. I understand. So for those of you
who break that down a little bit, if you can.
Yes, exactly. I was just about to. No, thanks for asking that, Jakari. Because so for those of you who don't know, again, this is, remember when I said earlier, since June 2019, there's stronger tenant protections. This is what this person who's asking this question is referring to, okay? And it's an important question. On June 14th, 2019, you know, the legislature passed a lot of protections for rent-regulated tenants. So remember, that means rent-controlled and rent-stabilized. Folks have even stronger protections than they did before, all right? There's a lot of them, so I'm not gonna get into it, but I'm gonna focus on what this person is asking. One of those protections was making preferential rents permanently or permanent for the tenants, okay? This is the way it worked, all right? So let me start with this. What is a preferential rent? So for a rent-regulated apartment, remember I told you that the landlord has to register every year with DHCR, saying how much they charge, what the lease amount, the term is, all of that. Okay. That is what's called, there's something called the legal regulated rent. That means the rent that the landlord is allowed to charge you for your rent regulated apartment, because it can only go up by certain percentages every year. You all will know this, okay? That's called the legal regulated rent. However, landlords can offer something called preferential rent. That is a rent that's lower than the legal regulated rent, okay? So if you have a rent regulated house, you have the legal regulated rent here, okay? That means the landlord's allowed to charge you that much, or they're saying they're allowed to charge you that much, okay? But then they might offer you a preferential rent that's lower than what they're allowed to charge you, okay? So for example, if they're allowed to charge you $1,500 a month for your apartment, but they might say, you know what? I like you. I'll rent this apartment to you for $1,000 a month, even though I'm allowed to charge you $1,500, right? That's what's called a preferential rent. All right. Before the law passed in June 2019, okay, the landlords were allowed to take away the preferential rent whenever they wanted. Whenever the rent regulated tenant renewed their lease, they could just take it away. All right. After June 2019, they cannot do that. If you are a rent regulated tenant and you have a preferential rent, the landlord, has to keep that preferential rent, all right? The landlord is allowed to do the small increases every year that the government allows. The landlord can do that, but it has to be based off the preferential, okay? So to go back to my example, landlord could have charged you $1,500 a month, but said, hey, I like you. I'll give you $1,000 a month. That's called the preferential rent here, right? You know, before June 2019, after your lease expired, they could say, hey, guess what? I'm jumping it up to $1,500 plus the increase, okay? After June 2019, they cannot do that. The landlord can still go up by the small increase the government allows, like 5%, for example, but they have to do it based off the $1,000 preferential rent. They cannot jump you anymore, okay? This applies only to people who are rent-regulated tenants who had a preferential rent in effect at the time the law went into effect, okay? So what does that mean? Let's go back to our example. $1,500 legal rent, but the landlord is giving you $1,000 a month, right? Preferential rent. If you renewed your lease in May 2019, literally 1 month before the law changed, but the landlord jumped you up, you're unfortunately out of luck because they were allowed to do that back then, right? But if your lease was in effect and you had this preferential $1,000, when the law went into effect, the landlord stopped. So every year when you every year or 2 years when you renew, they can only go up by the percentages based off this lower preferential rent. Okay.
Okay. That's it. Thank you.
Yes.
We have another question in Spanish. Mm-hmm. So I have Daniel Apple.
That's too general. I don't know what type of agreement, if it's oral, verbal, if it's a lease, if it's a settlement agreement. So I don't know. All your rights, your defenses, your counterclaims would totally be dependent on the facts.
Okay. Another question, the person following up about the harassment, about where could they find a harassment lawyer, if we can direct them to anyone. I'm not sure if you know of anyone, Jeremiah. Do you?
I don't. When I said it's extremely difficult, I wasn't kidding, unfortunately.
Okay.
Yeah. I will say this. Let me say this. This is important to say. If there's a group of people who can allege harassment in some way, that gives you a better chance of finding a lawyer. You could find a free lawyer because there's a lot of legal services offices like the Legal Aid Society, Manhattan Legal Services, MFJ, all these people, right? That a lot of them have group practices where they file HP cases that include harassment sometimes, but on behalf of groups. So if you have a group of any sort, even if it's a small group, big group, whatever, and you can find a way to have a claim, you have a better chance at finding a free lawyer, and you should call these different offices. But on an individual basis, unfortunately, it's just harsh.
Okay. So that will conclude our Q&A for tonight. Thank you, Jeremiah, so much for, you know, being on this webinar, providing us with all the wisdom and educating us on the court system and all aspects of non-payments and holdovers, and for answering each question in such great detail and being so informative. If anyone on this call needs further assistance, please contact Palante directly at 212-491-2541. This webinar will be uploaded on our YouTube, so you can share this with your neighbor or family members who may be experiencing the legal situations we discussed tonight. Also, I want to say thank you to our interpreter, Daniel, who provided Spanish interpretation on a separate channel, the whole webinar. We greatly appreciate him. And thank you to all the attendees who joined us and asked questions. I hope all questions were answered, and I hope to see you all on our next webinar. So I'm gonna put up a short poll right now just so we can know how tonight's webinar went. I know due to this webinar being a little overtime, usually you do it for an hour, this kind of went to 2 hours. So, you know, some people drifted off. So I'm happy that we still have a lot of people still here. But if you guys could just answer that for me so we can, know how tonight went, so I could share with Jeremiah, so we could have your feedback. That would be great. But, you know, this concludes tonight, and I hope everyone has a wonderful weekend and a wonderful night. Jeremiah, do you have any closing words that you want to say?
I just thank everyone for your time tonight, and I sincerely hope that it was helpful.